guys, it's Kelly. I think it's going to be pretty obvious right away that this is not a typical video for me. When I first started my channel, I wanted you to know who I was, and I told you that I have some health problems, and I told you that it was a good day that day, but today's not a good day. So, I'm getting more comfortable with getting on camera and sharing with you guys. I think that you guys are so supportive and so kind. And so, I thought that I would kind of share today a little bit about what's going on with me today. I have fibromyalgia. And you may know someone with fibromyalgia and you may not. To put it simply, fibromyalgia is overactive nerve endings in your body, which means that I have all over body pain all the time. A good way to help you understand how I feel, if you've ever had the flu, let's say you've got the flu and you've got a really bad case of the flu and you've got a temperature and your body hurts. Your body hurts really bad from the fever and just from the flu virus itself. I would consider that a normal to good day for me. I feel that way all the time. That's why I told you in my empties video that I go through a lot of over-the-counter pain medicines, because when your brain and your emotional and mental state is such that you are already coping with pain and other things additionally, when you're already coping with those kinds of things, even a headache or, you know, the slightest, you know, kind of discomfort kind of pushes you over the threshold that you can tolerate. So today's a bad day for me. I'm just hanging out in the bed. It's about 2:30 in the afternoon. I normally, when I have days like this, I normally just try to sleep them away. I become real reclusive. And I kind of just get in my bed and or never even get out of my bed. The only time I get up is when my dog has to go out. And also when, you know, I need to go to the restroom or anything like that. And I do try to keep some fluids beside me on my nightstand. There are a lot of things that you can have as a result of fibromyalgia. Fibromyalgia is sort of like a little umbrella, and underneath it, there's lots of other things that go along with it. It shouldn't be a surprise, but when you feel like this every day of your life, and you don't get any relief at all, it shouldn't be any surprise that you suffer from depression and anxiety. I've suffered with depression and anxiety it actually started, I guess I would say that I was diagnosed with fibromyalgia 16 years ago, but I never had any depression or anxiety or anything like that until I got pregnant with my son. So that would be about 18 years ago, roughly, because he'll be 17 this March. So, you know, like 9 months of pregnancy, approximately 18 years ago. I was pregnant, and I was at work. I went to the ladies' room for my break time to use the bathroom. And I noticed that I was spotting. And I did not feel well. I was kind of, I guess you would say kind of fluttery inside. It was anxiety at the time. I didn't know what it was. I just knew that I felt really bad and I felt like I needed help. It's hard to explain. I went to my principal and I told her, I said, something's wrong. I don't feel well and I'm spotting. I'm hurting. I was hurting in my lower abdomen. And I told her, I said, something's really wrong. And she said, do I need to take you to the ER? And I said, I think you do. Well, on the way, I called my OBGYN. And I told him what was going on. He said, don't go to the ER. Just come on up here to the office. So that's what we did. He said, I'll make room for you. Just come in. Tell him who you are. And he said, we'll get you back. And I'll check you immediately. Well, at the time, he said, you know, I think you're okay. He said, but you have an irregular heartbeat at the time. And he said, it's not uncommon for pregnant women to experience tachycardia, which is, you know, it's where your heartbeat's a little irregular. You feel it flutter, you know, that sort of thing. He told me to take Benadryl because that was the only thing that was safe while I was pregnant, to calm me down, to give me a sense of calm. So he told me to take Benadryl, and that's what I did. A week later was supposed to be our you know, appointment to find out what we were going to have, and we went to the doctor, and of course the first thing they do is the ultrasound. And the nurse acted really weird. She didn't tell us, you know, one way or the other. And we asked her and she said, I need to get the doctor to see you first. Well, long story short, I had miscarried. And he told me, he said, I need you here at 6 o'clock in the morning. We need to do a DNC. That rocked my boat. It never ever occurred to me that wasn't even possible. I mean, I had heard of so few people that had miscarried that it never occurred to me that it was a possibility for me, you know, for it to happen to me. So that was a pretty devastating, you know, kind of thing for me, of course. It took me about 6 months to get to the point where I was willing to try to start having, you know, try to get pregnant again. And I got pregnant right away with my son. But I was scared my whole pregnancy. I had a good pregnancy. It was, you know, I mean, I did well with the pregnancy and everything. But, I had a normal vaginal birth. It was, you know, I did not have any problems. And I loved being pregnant, even though I was, you know, scared. Every time I went to the bathroom, I was scared, you know, that I might find something I didn't want to see. And so once I got to the 12-week mark, I felt pretty good because I had miscarried the first time, or the time that I miscarried, it was 8 weeks. So it was really early in the pregnancy. And, he told me that, he asked me how the tachycardia was going. And I told him I was fine. You know, it didn't seem to be bothering me that I had quit taking the Benadryl. I felt like I had calmed down, that sort of thing. So for the rest of my pregnancy, I did not, I didn't have any more issues with, you know, an irregular heartbeat, or that there's this feeling or sense of doom that kind of hangs over your head when you're depressed and when you have anxiety. And so after he was born at noon. And by 11 o'clock that night, I was crying uncontrollably. I could not understand why I felt the way I felt. I couldn't explain where the sadness was coming from. I was so anxious that I wanted to go home right then and there. Didn't want to stay in the hospital. Didn't care if he came home with me or not. I just absolutely needed to go home. I begged, well, my husband then, I begged him, please get me out of here, take me home. And he was trying to talk reason with me. Of course, I wasn't, you know, I wasn't, there was very little reason there. That's where everything started, was after my pregnancy. I had a huge hormonal drop, and my serotonin levels were like at zero. If you don't know anything about serotonin, it's sort of like your emotional or your mood stabilizer in your brain. It's sort of like, you know, it's the chemical in your brain that really does, you know, if you're low in serotonin, it causes depression and things like that. So not long after my pregnancy, I was diagnosed with depression. I mean, years went by, the times that I was spending trying to find a medication that would help me. And during that time, I'm sorry that I'm moving around, but I'm hurting. during that time, I developed anxiety. So after about a year of going through a lot of different things, I had issues with my body, different things bothering me for years. Not the depression and anxiety, but other things. I had irritable bowel syndrome. I had a hard time going to sleep. I had sleep issues. You know, I had these aches and these pains that were in my joints that felt like sometimes I just felt like I couldn't even make a fist. And I didn't understand that. I had really weak wrists, and, you know, my body just hurt so bad all over, all the time. I had a lot of headaches. I was having migraines, the kind that, like, literally it blinds you. I couldn't stand it. I had to stay in the bed. They started me on preventative and migraine medicine in case I had one anyway with preventative. Guys, I've been through so much. I had my gallbladder removed. I had a hysterectomy. I had so many things that I was going through. During the midst of all this, I was teaching and I was working with special ed students, and they were young. And we worked on daily living skills. We were getting potty trained. They were 4 and 5 years old, but we were teaching them, you know, we were trying to help potty train them. We were teaching them to brush their teeth. We were teaching them how to hold a fork or a spoon to eat. You know, their fine motor skills were just like at zero, and some of them were nonverbal. So when they would act out, they would act out, you know. And there was one little boy, he was precious. His name was John. I loved John so much. And I kind of took him on as my own. But he was a pretty big guy for 5 years old. He weighed a lot. I lifted him and I hurt my back. And like the next week, I got hit from behind in the car and it hurt my back again. So, I found out that I have 3 bulging discs in the lumbar area of my back. And I had already been having some pretty severe pain in my hip and in the shoulder. Like, if you have neck strain from sitting at a computer all day typing or whatever. Yeah, I had that. It hurt right in there all the time. But my lower back and my hip, it was about to kill me. So, I went in, and I had several pain blocks done. I had bursitis a couple of times. Just a lot of physical issues. I've been through tremendous amounts of physical therapy and different forms of physical therapy. Everything from water therapy to, you know, standing at a ballet bar, squatting back and forth. You know, it went on and on and on and on. I couldn't figure out why. I was in my mid-30s, and I felt like I was 90 years old. I was taking a buttload of medications. I was teaching. It's not like I could leave my classroom. I would alternate between constipation and diarrhea. And I'm talking about diarrhea that it would cramp so bad it would take my breath. And it would go on for days if I didn't take Imodium. So I would take Imodium constantly. Just trying to control it enough so that I could stay in my classroom. The panic attacks started after I came home from the hospital with my son. I had my first one. He was up all night overnight until he was 2.5 years old. My mom was with me the first week. My husband took off the first week as well, so there were three of us there. And I was trying to breastfeed. And I just couldn't do it, guys. I just couldn't do it. I tried so hard. But the I was so uncomfortable with it because I felt claustrophobic. He wanted to eat for an hour at a time every 30 minutes. I couldn't produce enough milk to satisfy him. And the constant having him latched on me created a claustrophobia that I can't really explain. So I had these pain blocks. One helped, one didn't. So my pain management doctor, he told me, he said, you know what? He said, you've got a lot going on. He said, you really have a lot going on. And he said, I think I know what you've got. He said, I want you to see our rheumatologist here. He said, because I think that he can sort it out for you. And I said, well, what do you think I have? I mean, because I had been to one specialist after another. I was chronically sick. I had a terrible immune system. I had had sinus surgery. And guys, I mean, I literally had been through hell at that point, as it was. So he said, well, honestly, he said, it's one of two things, and I'm pretty sure it's one of them. He said, you've either got lupus or you've got fibromyalgia. Well, I'd heard of lupus. Never heard of fibromyalgia before. I never heard of it, didn't know anything about it. He said, I want you to see our rheumatologist because he can evaluate you. My eyes are so swollen. I haven't had much sleep. I'm so tired, and I'm hurting really bad. Long story short, I was diagnosed with fibromyalgia. I mean, it didn't take much. Fibromyalgia, you have, with it, you have tender points in your body. And they usually, if you have 18 of the most common tender points, which is when they mash you, it creates, you know, severe pain. Usually they start with 18. He counted 36 on me. But 18 is all that it took for, him to diagnose me with fibro. But he did some blood tests and everything to make sure that I didn't have rheumatoid arthritis or anything like that, or lupus, you know, those kinds of things. Once everything else was ruled out and he had diagnosed me with fibromyalgia, I started taking Lyrica. And I started seeing a psychiatrist because my depression and my anxiety was really bad. I also went to the mitral valve center. And I started seeing a doctor because I found out that I have severe mitral valve along with dysautonomia. Dysautonomia, there's all kinds of different dysautonomias out there or whatever. But mine is, it pretty much centers around the fact that my brain does not signal my body to create blood volume. So I have to drink enough fluids each day to make up for the blood volume that I don't create on my own. I can't give blood. When they try to take blood just for a regular test, it's very difficult. It's a long drawn out process. Usually ends up with me passing out because they're digging around with a needle in my arm. I've been stuck everywhere. I've been stuck between the toes. I've been stuck everywhere just trying to get a blood sample. It's been a very difficult road. This is just a very quick overview of some of the things that I've been through. Fibromyalgia is really aggravated by stress. And it also is a lot like rheumatoid arthritis in that I can feel the weather changes. And the weather changes make me feel a lot different. Right now, outside, it's nearly mid-March, and it's not just a wind. I mean, it's like gale force. It is so windy outside. I mean, it's coming in like a line, March is. And so, but when you go out, it is a very hot air that's whipping around. And it's almost suffocating because the barometric pressure is dropping. When the barometric pressure drops, I get a weather headache, and it makes my fibro, and it just, my body hurts so deep to the core that it's an effort just to talk about it, really. It hurts to touch my hair. It hurts. My skin's tender. It just hurts to touch me, period. I feel like my body is trying to kill itself from the inside out. There's no way to explain how I feel. I can only use the words I know, and that is that I'm experiencing an extreme amount of pain. It's supposed to come a huge storm tonight. And I believe it with the hot air that's whipping around outside. It's very abnormal for this time of year in Alabama. And, you know, they've predicted storms, so I'm really not surprised. But I didn't get to sleep last night. And so it was really late. Well, actually early this morning before I ever fell asleep. And I got up a couple of times to take my dog out. I've had a cup of coffee, and I've got a couple of bottles of water beside the bed here for me. But this is one of those days where I'll just spend. I probably won't leave the bed. My dog gets very concerned about me when I'm like this. She always wants to just be right up on top of me. My bed's really high, and she can't jump up here. I put her down so I could tape or video. This is one of those days where if I'm not asleep, then Netflix binge or YouTube binge. because it hurts so bad. My back hurts. My legs hurt. My feet hurt. My wrists hurt. Everything hurts. I have a lot of other health conditions that I'll talk about all this in more depth later on. I'll try to break it down, you know, and talk about it, because all of this affects my weight. And I've told you before that I'm very self-conscious about my weight. The meds that I take create a lot of the weight that I have on me. And I live a fairly sedentary lifestyle. Because of the pain that I'm in, you know, it's hard. It's not like I can just go to the gym and bust out a workout. That's just not an option for me. My joints can't take it. And so, you know, I can walk. But when you're depressed, there's not much motivation. And when you have anxiety, it is a feeling that you cannot shake. It is a black cloud over your head that follows you everywhere. You feel like you want to have a running fit, cry, hit the wall, all at the same time. It absolutely controls, and I mean, it absolutely controls the way that I feel. I don't want it to, but it does. And so when I'm high anxiety, and my depression's high, the barometric pressure is dropping. It's a very bad mixture for me. So today is a bad day. And I felt like I could share that with you. I'm going to probably spend the rest of the day today in the bed. I'll sleep on and off. The storm will come tomorrow or tonight. Tonight or tomorrow. the storm will come. I feel it. Once it's gone and out of here and clears up, I'll feel a little bit better. But for right now, I have the absolute worst weather headache. And my body hurts everywhere. Eating is, it's an emotional comfort for me. But when I'm like this, I don't even want to eat. I'm just, all I really want to do is just lay here in the bed. So I've got my Netflix here and I've got my laptop with YouTube. And, that's going to be my day today. I'm not asking for any kind of sympathy or pity or anything like that. I'm definitely not asking for any kind of suggestions or anybody to tell me what I should or should not be doing. When you've lived with something for 16 years, you know everything about it. You know what does work and what doesn't work. And sometimes, even family, they say things to you thinking that they're helping, but it ends up making the depression or anxiety worse, even though they're truly just trying to help. So if you're not familiar with fibro, if you have it, you understand what I'm saying. But if you don't have it, even if you have a family member that has it, if you don't have it yourself, you don't understand. And it's one of those things where suggesting that I get up and move around, suggesting that I get out more, suggesting that I get some exercise, or saying, well, it can't be that bad. Those things are so incredibly hurtful to a person like myself and others that suffer from chronic illness. So, I told you in the beginning that I needed this channel to be a positive place. And this is the reason why. I need support from you guys. I don't need judgment. I don't need suggestions. I just need, if you have it, I need you to say, just, I'm there with you, girl, and I understand. Hugs. Gentle hugs. Because it hurts to hug somebody. It really does. I dread when somebody tries to shake my hand, because it feels like they're just going to tear my hand off the end of my arm. So, this is getting pretty long. I felt comfortable enough that I could share this with you. And I just wanted you to kind of see what a bad day looks like for me. I hope that you can understand that when I have these bad days, that I'm not going to share them all with you or anything like that. But I wanted you to see, you know, life has different facets. And I have, you know, good sides and bad sides and okay sides and not so good, you know, okay sides. And guys, I just would like for you to, you know, be positive with your, you know, comments and encouraging with your comments. Because if there are other people watching this video that suffer with some of the things that I have, I'm not saying it just for me, I'm saying it for them too. We already know what we need to be doing. We already know that we can't do it because we hurt too much, especially when it's a bad day. We've already been to our doctors, and our doctors are already treating us. So I need your comments to be positive, not just for me, but for other viewers also. And I need for you to just try to understand that I'm sharing with you because I feel like I can. You've become a support system for me, and I appreciate what you do. Your sweet comments and those kinds of things. I'm gonna go now. I feel like I'm really bearing a lot here to share this with you, but you know, you're my YouTube family now. I have a lot of people that watch me, and I feel like I can trust you. So that's why I'm sharing this with you today. I hope that I feel better. If there's anybody watching this that's going through what I'm going through, I hope that you feel better. I hope that one day there won't be just a treatment, but there'll be a cure. And, yeah. I just felt like you deserved to kind of see what I deal with and to understand, you know, why I don't work, why I lost my career, and, you know, other things that's happened in my life that I'll share at another time. So, be positive. Be kind-hearted. Be kind to someone today, because you don't know what battles they're fighting. And I just wanted to say thank you for listening to me. And God bless. Bye, guys.